Okay, now we're going to continue with a new topic called hidden Markov models. We're going to be using hidden Markov models for many different NLP tasks, including part-of-speech tagging, but first let's see how they work. So the first concept that I want to introduce today is the idea of a Markov model, a visible Markov model, not a hidden Markov model. We'll get to hidden models later. So a Markov model is a sequence of random variables that are not independent. So for example, it could be weather report. So the weather report, the temperature on a given day depends somewhat on the temperature on the previous day. It can be text. So the probability of the next word or the next letter depends on the previous word or the previous letter respectively. So here's some properties of Markov models. They have to have a limited horizon. So the probability of the observation at time t plus one has to depend only on the probabilities of the most recent history. So just the most previous word or the previous few words. It's also time invariant. So the probability of seeing a certain variable at a certain time should not depend on the time itself. So the definition of a Markov model is in terms of a transition matrix A, which tells us what the probability is for moving from one state to another, and also an initial state probability is pi. So here's an example with six states, A, B, C, D, E, F. We now can define the probability distribution for transitions between those states. So here are the specific numbers. We start from state D. And then from state D, if you look at all the arcs that go out of that state, we can go to state number, to state A with a probability of 0.7. We can go to state C with a probability of 0.1. And we can go to state F with a probability of 0.2. If we are in state A, we can go to A, back to A with a probability of 0.2, or go to state B with a probability of 0.8. You can do the same thing for the remaining four states. And one thing that is pretty obvious here is that given any particular state, the sum of the probabilities of all the outgoing transitions is equal to 1. So that makes sure that they form a probability distribution. So if we want to compute the probability of a sequence of states, x1 to xt, we can use the chain rule that we introduced in an earlier lecture. That gives us the formula p of the first observation, the first state, times the probability of the second state given the first state, times the probability of the third state given the previous two, and so on, times the probability of the last state given all of the states before. So this is the most general formula for the joint distribution x1 to xt. Now, but using the Markov assumption and using a bigram model, we can change this to the probability of observing x1 times the probability of observing x2 given x1 times the probability of observing x3 given only x2. At this point, we are ignoring some of the history, particularly x1 in this example, by only looking at the two most recent states. And then the final term is just xt given xt minus 1 instead of xt given everything before xt. So in compact form, this is the product of all the xi plus 1 bigrams for the sequence starting from I equals 1 to I equals t minus 1. So what's the probability in the example here that we're going to see the sequence DAB? Well, that's the probability that the first state is D times the probability that the second state is A given that the first state was D times the probability that the third state is B given that the previous one was A. And we can replace those probabilities with the numbers from the specific example and get that the first one is 1, the second one is 0.7, the third one is 0.8. And if we multiply them, we can see that the sequence DAB has a probability of 0.56. We can do the same thing for any other sequence of probabilities. And in this particular example, because we assume that the start state is always state D, that means that any sequence that starts with a symbol other than D is going to have a probability of 0. Okay, now let's look at the hidden Markov model, which is something that is much more appropriate for language modeling than a visible Markov model. So in part-of-speech tagging, for example, we are observing a sequence of symbols, and we don't know the sequence of states that led to the generation of those symbols. So in part-of-speech tagging, the symbols that we observe are the actual words, and the sequence of states are the parts of speech that correspond to those words. The definition of a hidden Markov model is the following. A Q is a sequence of states observed, O is a sequence of observations drawn from a vocabulary. Q0 and QF are specific start and final states. A is the set of state transition probabilities, just like in the visible model. But we now also have a new set of parameters called B, which is known as the symbol emission probabilities. Essentially, if you're in a given state, what's the probability that you're going to emit a certain symbol from that state? And you can also have pi, just like with the visible model, which is the initial state probabilities. Mu, which is the union of A, B, and pi, is the complete probabilistic model that determines the hidden Markov model. And in many of the machine learning algorithms that we're going to look at, one of the goals will be to find out the values of mu, which is equivalent to saying to find the values of A, B, and pi. So hidden Markov models are used in pattern speech tagging, in speech recognition, in gene sequencing, and many other areas of research. So they are used to model state sequences and also observation sequences. For example, we want to find out the probability that a certain set of states is correlated with a certain set of words. And in a bigram model, we can essentially write this as the product of all the bigram probabilities of going from one state to the next times the probability of emitting a certain symbol W sub I when we are in state S sub I. So here's a very simple example. The sequence of states is S0 to Sn. And when we are in state 1, we produce W1 as an output symbol. When we're in state 2, we produce W2, and so on all the way to Sn. When we're in state Sn, we produce the word Wn as the output. So the HMM algorithm is a generative algorithm. We're going to start by picking a state from the initial distribution pi, based on the probabilities in pi. Then for a set of t consecutive steps, capital T consecutive steps, we're going to move to another state based on the previous state and based on the probability given by the transition matrix A. And then we're going to also emit an observation based on B. B, just to remind you, is the matrix of emission probabilities. So here's an example. We have two states, A and B. They're all connected to each other with certain probabilities. And specifically, the probability of going from A to B is 0.2. The probability of staying in A is 0.8. The probability of going from B to A is 0.6. And the probability of staying in B when you are already in B is 0.4. And just to remind you, as before, the probabilities that come out of the same node or the same state should add up to 1. And you can verify that this is the case here. Now we can also define a start symbol or a start state or starting probability. In this case, unambiguously, we're going to start in state A, so the probability of starting in B is 0. Now let's look at some specific examples. Now we're interested in the probability of a certain sequence of observations at time t. So what's the probability of the observation at time t to be equal to k, given that we are currently in a certain state and that the previous state is given as well? So this is now our emission probability matrix. If we are in state A, we are much more likely to produce symbol X with a probability of 0.7. We are less likely to produce Y or Z because their probabilities are 0.2 and 0.1 respectively, and yet it is still possible to produce them. From state B, we are most likely to produce symbol Y with a probability of 0.5, but we can also produce X and Z with probabilities of 0.3 and 0.2 respectively. So what are the parameters of the model? Well, the initial parameters are the probability of A given start is 1.0. The probability of B given start is 0.0. This corresponds to the start transition that I had in the earlier diagram. The transition probabilities are given here. P of A given A is 0.8. P of A given B is 0.6. P of B given A is 0.2. And P of B given B is 0.4. Now the emission probabilities, P of X given A is 0.7, and so on, just like on the previous slide. So you can see that the parameters of the model are all shown here. We have a total of 12 parameters. Later on, when we talk about learning the parameters of an HMM, we're going to refer to those 12 parameters collectively as the parameter set mu, or the model mu. Now let's look at an example. We want to figure out what's the probability that we're going to observe the sequence YZ from this automaton. So we're going to start in state A, and we can consider all the possible sequences of states. we can start in A and go back to A. We can start in A, switch to B. We can move to B next and then go to A. And finally, we can go to B and then stay in B. In each of those sequences of states can lead to a certain probability for the observation YZ. So if we can want to consider the probability of YZ given a set of a sequence of two steps, we have to consider the probability of YZ being generated from the sequence AA, the probability of YZ being generated from the sequence AB, the probability of YZ being generated from BA, and finally the probability of YZ being generated from the sequence BB. The sum of those four is going to give us the full probability of the sequence of the observations YZ. So the first one of those four terms is 0.8. That's the probability of staying in A, given that we started in A, times the probability of emitting the character Y from state A, which is 0.2, times the probability of staying in A for a second time, that's 0.8, times the probability of emitting Z from state A, which is equal to 0.1. The second term, we get 0.8 times 0.2, which matches the previous line. But now we have also the probability of going from A to B, which is 0.2, times the probability of emitting a Z from state B, which is also 0.2. Then we can do the same thing for the rest of the formula. I'm going to give you a second to think about it and try to fill those numbers by yourselves. Okay, so now let me give you the answers to this question. The probability of producing YZ given the state sequence BA is equal to 0.2, which is the probability of going from A to B, times 0.5, which is the probability of producing Y in state B, times 0.4, which is the probability of going from B to A, times 0.2, which is the probability of generating Z from state A. And the last line is very similar, is 0.2 times 0.5, times the probability of going from B to B, which is 0.6, times the probability of emitting Z from state B, which is 0.1. If you add up all those numbers here, you're going to see that the overall probability of the sequence YZ is equal to 0.0332, about 3%. So relatively speaking, this is a very unlikely sequence, given that there are 9 possible sequences of X, Y, and Z. Each one on average would be expected to appear about 11% of the time. This particular one is unlikely. It only has a probability of 0.3. And this is kind of obvious if you look at the original example, because to produce Y and Z, none of the states A and B gives them a high probability. It would have been much more likely, given that we started in state A, that we would produce a sequence that contains at least one X. So let me finish this example here. We can similarly compute the probability of the sequence ZZ or YX or XZ and so on. And the probability of all of those sequences will need to add up to 1, because those are all the possible and disjoint alternatives that we can get as observations if we start in state A. So a little bit of background. The states are essentially used to encode the most recent history. They don't necessarily have to include the most recent part of speech. They can include the most recent several parts of speech. But in the bigram model, they will just encode the most recent part of speech. The transitions encode the likely sequences of states. So for example, we looked at this example before. An article cannot be followed by a verb. Therefore, the probability of jumping from the article state to a verb state is going to be very low. It's much more likely to go from an adjective to a noun. So the probability of the state sequence adjective noun is going to be relatively higher. It's also possible to have sequences of more than two words that have high probability. For example, the sequence article adjective noun is very likely in English. Therefore, we expect that this sequence of two bigram probabilities to be high. So how do we estimate the transition probabilities? Again, we have to use a maximum likelihood estimate. And one possible way to do this is if we have a training corpus, for example, for part of speech tagging, we can just look at the sequence of adjacent parts of speech and use that to estimate the probability of the transition. Now let's consider the case of the emission probabilities. Estimating the emission probabilities is actually a little bit harder than transition probabilities because there may be novel uses of specific combinations of words and parts of speech. So a specific word may have appeared once in the training data as one part of speech, but then in the test set it may appear with a completely different part of speech. So here's some suggestions that can be used. It's possible to use standard smoothing, just like in the previous lecture. And it's also possible to use heuristics, for example, based on the spelling of the words. Okay, so now let's look at the sequence of observations. So very often, in the case of an HMM, and that's essentially the reason why HMMs have been invented, it is the case that the observer can only see the emitted symbols and not the states that led to their generation. So one thing that you may want to compute is the observation likelihood. So given the observation sequence and the model, mu, which again consists of the transition matrix, the emission matrix, and the initial state probability, we want to compute the probability of the sequence given mu. Essentially, what's the probability that this sequence was generated by that particular model? So it turns out that being able to compute the probability of the observation sequence turns the HMM into a language model, because again, what is a language model? It's a way to compute the probability of a sequence or a sentence or a sequence of observations. So here are the most important tasks with HMMs. The first one is, given the probabilistic model A, B, pi, we want to find the probability of the observation given the model. The second task is, given the observation, or maybe a set of observations, and mu, we want to figure out what's the sequence of states that led to this observation. And finally, given an observation and a space of all the possible mu's, we want to find the mu that best describes the observations. So one of the most important tasks in HMM processing is called decoding, and that is the task of finding the most likely sequence. So we want to tag each token with a label. We can also find observation likelihood for classification of sequences, and we can learn by training models to fit empirical data. So let's look at one of those examples first. We want to do inference now. So the task of inference is to find the most likely sequence of tags given the sequence of words. So this is essentially the same idea that will be used later on in part-of-speech tagging. We are looking at the sequence of words, and we want to predict the sequence of parts of speech. So given all the possible T's, sequences of tags, we want to pick the one, T star, that maximizes the probability of P of T given W. So if we know the model mu, it's possible to compute the probability of T given W using the generative model for the HMM for all the values of T. But in practice, there's too many combinations to make this feasible. So one possible solution is to use beam search. Essentially, just look at all the partial hypotheses after a certain point in time in the observation sequence. Maybe just skip the top 10 or 100 or 1,000 and assume that no sequence will reach the end of the sentence that will have a probability that was skipped by the beam search. So this method may not work because it's very possible that the first few words lead us into one state and we have to discard a very viable hypothesis just because it has a low probability so far, only to find out that it is actually the best hypothesis when we reach the end of the sequence. So instead of doing this, we can come up with a much more important algorithm called the Viterbi algorithm. This is one of the most fundamental algorithms in natural language processing. It's based on dynamic programming, and it is used to find the best path up to a specific observation I. So if we apply it on the entire sequence, it will tell us the probability of the entire sentence. But if we apply it only to the first word or the second word, it only gives us the best path up to that point. So again, it uses dynamic programming and it uses memoization. Just to remind you what memoization means, it's essentially a way to store the probabilities of any subsequence that has already been computed so that you don't have to compute it again in the future. We used a similar technique in parsing when we looked at the CKY algorithm. And another important characteristic is back pointers. So we want to keep track not only of the best path that takes us to a certain state, but also on how we got to that point. So here's an example. I'm going to introduce the so-called HMM trellis or lattice. Here's what it looks like. It has, in this example, four rows and four columns. Each column corresponds to one time unit. So we start in state T0, time T0, then we go to time T1, then T2 and T3. What are the rows? Well, the first row corresponds to the first possible part of speech. That's the start symbol. The second and third row correspond to two of the other parts of speech A and B. And finally, we have one that corresponds to the end state. So what we're looking for is a sequence that takes us from the start node in the lower left-hand corner to the end state in the upper right-hand corner and going through a sequence of A's and B's in each column. So for example, if we have a sequence of two words, they will be encoded in the second and third column. And what we want to find out here is whether they were generated by a sequence AA or a sequence AB or BA or BB. And I have used solid circles for the states that can actually be reached at any given point in time and dotted circles for the states that cannot really be reached and are just there for completeness. So let's see how we're going to now define the transitions from a given state to another state. So the probability of node A in the second column is going to be equal to the probability of observing the symbol Y in the YZ sequence, given that we're in state A. Then we're going to have a transition from state A to state B when moving from the Y observation to the Z observation. And finally, to get to the end of the sequence, we're going to have a transition from state B to state B. So let's look at this in more detail. So we're going to start the Viterbi algorithm by starting in the start state. From the start state, we can go to either A or B with a certain probability. What is the probability of A at time 1? Well, the probability of A at time 1 is equal to the probability of starting times the probability of A given the start state times the probability of emitting the symbol Y given that we're in state A. Similarly, we can choose to go to B. In that case, we want to compute the probability of B at time 1 as the product of the starting probability times the probability of getting to B from the start state times the probability of emitting Y from the B state. Now, on the next iteration, we want to compute the probability of B at time equals 2. Well, there are two possible ways to get there. We can go from start to A and from A to B, or we can go from start to B and from B to B. So the probability of B at time 2 is going to be equal to the sum of the probabilities through each of those two paths. The first path has a probability of A at time 1 times the probability of going from A to B times the probability of emitting Z when we're in state B. And the second path has the product of starting at state B at time 1, then transferring to state B at time 2, and finally emitting Z from state B. So we're going to pick this value and assign it to the circle that says B at time 2. And we're going to pick the one that is the larger of the two. So in this case, it's the block arrow. So it's more likely to get to state B given the observation YZ if we went first to state B and then stayed in state B than it is if we went to A first and then switched back to B. Okay, so now we can give a back pointer that goes from state B at time 2 to state B at time 1 and then back to start at time 0. Now at the end, what we want is to compute the probability of getting to an end state at time equals 3. And as you can see, this lattice shows us all the possible ways to get there. And the Viterbi algorithm is going to help us compute this probability by making it easier. So the probability of the end state at time 3 is just going to be the maximum of the two possible ways to get there from time 2, specifically going from state A to the end state and going from state B to the end state. And also in each case, we have to multiply by the probability of emitting an end symbol given A and an end symbol given B. So whatever path is best is going to be encoded in the state that corresponds to the end symbol at time 3. And that is going to be the overall probability of generating the sequence YZ end of sentence given this particular HMM. And the set of back pointers is going to tell us that in this particular case, it's most likely that we went through the sequence B, B, end. This concludes this example here. Okay, so we just went over an example of the Viterbi algorithm using HMMs and the HMM trellis. We're going to continue with HMMs in the next segment.